This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlove.
And welcome back to the second hour of Up North News Radio on this Wednesday morning, October 30th. 6 days to go until Election Day. Nice to have you along. Coming up this hour, State Senator Chris Larson is going to join us for our homeroom segment where we talk about public education, the opportunities, the threats, and one of the more recent ones deals with reading and literacy programs, new programs that were required, put in place by the Republican-controlled legislature, and then when it came time to fund them, they said, nah. So we'll get an update on what's happening with that. Up North News reporter Elizabeth Montemurro joins us in a couple of moments as well. She has been talking to candidates and VIPs crisscrossing Wisconsin in this final week of the campaign. But first, it is time for a true Halloween tale, the trick-or-treat comparison that is inevitable when you have temperatures that start out in the 70s the day before Halloween, but we're talking about snowflakes and cold air and wet rain by the time the kids are actually out trick-or-treating. Meteorologist Brittany Merlot has the details. Brittany, I know this is no fun to deliver, but it is what it is.
It is what it is, I guess, right? Oh my gosh, going from record high warm temperatures yesterday and even this morning, we're hitting record warm overnight lows. That's hard to say. It's a tongue twister. So it's the warmest overnight that we have had on this day so far. I mean, you can feel it. It's kind of eerie. You could just walk outside with no coat on, and It's almost Halloween. So after that, you know, we're just kind of hover here right now. We're in the upper 60s to low 70s. We'll spike a few degrees, maybe low 70s to mid 70s for the afternoon. And then we start to drop after that. That's, of course, as the rain rolls in, but the potential for some storms into southwestern parts of the state from Madison and westward. You could see some hail, damaging wind gusts, and honestly, tornadoes aren't even ruled out today. So it's a lot of wild weather. I mean, we're taking a 30-degree drop from yesterday, today's kind of vibe, through tomorrow. So a big difference in air masses slamming in together. You're going to get some heavy rain as well, especially into portions of central Wisconsin. I mean, we're looking at an excess of 2 inches, possibly. That could create some flash flooding. And then after all of this, we're going to see the rain really ramp up this afternoon into the evening, continuing overnight. It does look in the southern parts of the state to wind down by tomorrow afternoon. But up north, that's not the case. That's when it's going to really start to be flipping into some snowfall and accumulating as well. So we're looking at a wintry mix into northwest parts of the state by overnight, early tomorrow morning. And then it flips to all snow throughout the morning and potentially into the afternoon and maybe even flying still into the evening. Some of these accumulations could be around 2 to 5 inches, maybe 6 inches or more towards Duluth. It's going to be a lake effect snow machine on top of this system exiting and that cold, blustery wind blasting in. Today, winds are going to be gusting up to 40 miles per hour out of the south, keeping us warm. But by tomorrow, especially in the afternoon and evening, kids out trick-or-treating are going to feel it. It is going to be blustery, moving out of the north, gusting up to 45 miles per hour. So a dreaded, spooky forecast for trick-or-treating. Bundle up. It's icky.
Yeah, but although, I mean, look, we've been kind of spoiled, and the fact of the matter is we talk about Election Day all the time, but we forget that means it's November. It's going to be November here, and this is November weather that's going to come, like it or not. Did I ever tell you about the Halloween blizzard of 1991?
Oh, God, no, run away.
Yesterday. Sorry. quickly from Rob in Tigerton, good morning. It's cloudy and a summer-like 70 degrees. Yesterday, he was in Gillette and got to meet up with Kristen at a campaign event. Got a hat from her that I wear proudly. I took pictures of the people who leased my family's property combining the corn. We talked about War of the Worlds in the last segment. He said he remembers his dad and uncles talking about when it was on the radio and they had the neighbor kids over, and the neighbor kids were so scared they had to run to get them home just in case of, you know, aliens, things like that. And he finally notes you've got to be weather savvy later today.
You sure do.
Well said. I
mean, you got to be weather savvy and drink that water.
Yes, Greg. Just be aware. Brittany, thank you so much. Have a great
day.
Thank
you. You too.
All right. Like I said, 6 days until the election. Voting is already underway. Later this morning, we'll get the latest numbers that should indicate that through yesterday, more than 1 million of you have already voted, myself included, by either mailing your absentee ballots in or in-person early voting, which is happening all around you right now. Be in touch with your local clerk's office to learn more, or check out the voting guides at upnorthnewswi.com or Dan Schaefer's 2024 voter guide at civicmedia.us. This election campaign in such a swing state, such a closely divided state, can't help but bring in the candidates, the surrogates, the celebrities, the fans, and all the reporters who cover them, including Up North News reporter Elizabeth Montemaro, who joins us now to tell us more about all the folks that you're meeting out and about. Many of them real, some of them a little on the fictitious side, for those of you who might be fans of Olivia Pope. Details in a minute. Elizabeth, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Hanging in there, Pat. We're 6 days out.
Yeah, and like I said, a lot of different names coming through. We were talking about the cast of The West Wing recently, was in the Waukesha, Milwaukee area. And I mean, it not only attracted a crowd, but it was one of our more popular social media posts of the past week. And then there's another political show out there, or that had been out there, that was really popular in its day. And one of its stars has been busy campaigning in swing states like Wisconsin.
That's right. For any scandal fans, Kerry Washington made a campaign stop in Milwaukee over the weekend. She stopped at a field office here in Milwaukee on the northwest side. And just like the cast of The West Wing, was just there to talk to voters and volunteers, and of course bring the snacks, because those volunteers are logging some long hours at this point in the campaign, encouraging folks to get out and vote. But I think what was really interesting, you know, as Kerry Washington was there to encourage volunteers, give them a little bit of motivation as we're nearing the final days of the campaign, is that she's like, you know, I'm a celebrity, but I'm not here for me.
No, she's not. So let's listen to a bit from what Kerry Washington had to say to volunteers.
I'm not here as a celebrity. I'm here as an American. I'm here as a granddaughter of immigrant. I'm here as a mother. I'm here as a union member. I'm here as a daughter. I'm here just to love my country, and I'm never going to silence myself because of what I do for a living. I'm not here to tell people what to do because I'm Kerry Washington. I'm not here because I played a character, Olivia Pope, on television. These people always say, like, Olivia Pope, you have to fix this. Like, Olivia Pope, save us in this moment. But actually, Olivia Pope can't vote. She can't make phone calls. She can't knock on doors. She doesn't have the power that every single person living in Wisconsin has right now to really make a difference in this world. So I'm really here to say, you guys are so much more important than me. And I want people to know that in this celebrity-driven culture, that I'm not here for me. I'm here for you.
Exactly. And I can't help but note that campaigns get so busy that sometimes one person in a campaign office needs to say to somebody else, stop talking over there, we're doing an interview. But, you know, it is what it is. But it was, and I like that it sounds cliche, but, you know, when these celebrities, surrogates drop in, when they're bringing the box of donuts, when they're bringing the bag, I don't know if she had in those bags there, if they were cookies or donuts or whatever, you bring in the pizza. I mean, it makes a connection. It just says, you know, you're not there just for you. You give a damn about the volunteers too. And that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I thought so. You know, just like the cast of The West Wing a week and a half ago, they walked in with trays of donuts too. I was like, oh, It's a good move. May I have one?
Yeah, right. So, of course, the candidates are a big part of it as well. And Tammy Baldwin is on her own bus tour right now.
She is. She started a statewide bus tour, I believe 5 days long, this past weekend. And I had a chance to catch up with her on one of the stops yesterday at Apple Holler in Racine County. It was just a beautiful fall day to be out campaigning, maybe a little too warm for the setting, the beautiful fall setting that we had. But on this stop, Tammy was speaking with union members, mostly from United Food Service, food and commercial workers, and just asking people for their vote. She said, you know, I believe it's really important to be here to ask people, will you support me? Because people often forget that.
Yeah. No, you have to actually make the ask. Don't just say, oh, I did all this, I did all that. You have to ask. And, you know, she went on to say, sometimes you need to explain to one another why you're voting the way you do. Let's listen to Senator Baldwin on that.
I work on issues around wellness, work, and water. Those are areas that we can all relate to. You need your help. You need a good job to get ahead. And we need natural resources that we celebrate as Wisconsinites. You know, we're a state on two Great Lakes, and the mighty Mississippi is our west coast, and we care about our drinking water and the safety of our drinking water. And I fight a lot for that. So my why is to make sure that Wisconsin has somebody who's fighting every day for them, not somebody who insults them.
No, I think we know who she's talking about there. And finally, you're there in Southeast Wisconsin, and that included the first congressional district. We haven't talked much about the race there against incumbent Republican Brian Stile, but former congressman, former legislator Peter Barca is the candidate there.
There's a lot of talk in campaigns today about lowering costs, saving people money. But let's face it, healthcare is one of our most important values. It's the most important thing, and it's also the most expensive. And so if you want to lower costs, you'll do what was achieved in the Inflation Reduction Act, which was to make sure that we negotiated drug prices. And 152,000 Wisconsinites benefited from the first 10 drugs that were in fact included in that negotiation. So I would say healthcare is one of the most important issues people should be mindful of, because it is on the ballot in so many different ways.
The thing is, Elizabeth, you know, he contrasts himself with Brian Stile. How did Brian Stile do on the Inflation Reduction Act and matters that would have helped with health care?
Well, just like every other Republican in Congress, he voted against it.
That's right. And it just needed that little refresher, which Peter Barca was providing as well. Elizabeth Montemarle, thank you so much for, covering so many different things. We appreciate it. Have a great day.
Thanks, you too.
When we come back, we'll talk about something Ron Johnson had to say about voter fraud and where does it really exist. That's coming up next. You're up north.
You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
When the truth is found to be lies, and all the joy.
Grace Slick, happy birthday, 85 years old today. Senator Chris Larson from the Wisconsin Legislature joins us in about 15 minutes here to talk about reading and literacy programs and the Republicans in the legislature who mandated it but now refuse to fund it. That and much more ground we'll cover coming up in our second half hour here. But first, I wanted to start by mentioning that we have to remind you that Ron Johnson is one of Wisconsin's senators and that Eric Hovde is currently running to be essentially Ron Johnson's mini-me, so that we have two rich white guys who think that government should be run like a business and are willing to say or do pretty much anything to get into office. We certainly saw that with Ron Johnson a couple of years back when, again, despite being behind in polling and certainly behind in, shall we say, public approval, was willing to run or have billionaires on his behalf run enough wildly racist commercials to drag him across the finish line. And so we still have him. Will we have Eric Hovde in place of Tammy Baldwin? Ron Johnson certainly is hoping so and is already putting out messages like this one yesterday on Twitter. Ron Johnson writes, "Democrats oppose all efforts to secure elections. In other words, they want to make it easy to cheat, which means they want to cheat. No surprise, cheating is being exposed. Question is, how much cheating will they get away with?" Well, what does he mean by that when he says cheating is being exposed? Well, he points to a Donald Trump tweet about how in York County, Pennsylvania, they're dealing with potentially thousands of fraudulent voter registration forms and mail-in ballot applications from a third-party group that came in. The thing that Donald Trump's not telling you, the thing that Ron Johnson's not telling you, is that that third-party group is likely led by somebody by the name of Scott Pressler, who has been a tireless advocate for Donald Trump and for doing things that might seem a little underhanded, and he may have finally been caught helping to put thousands of potentially fraudulent ballots out there, and either by design or by design to get caught so that you create this headline that there's voter fraud out there, so that Donald Trump can tweet about it, so that Ron Johnson can tweet about it, because apparently Ron Johnson thinks that you forgot that he was in on Trump's plan to circumvent the election. He was ready to be a mule. He was ready to take fraudulent ballots from fake electors in Wisconsin to Mike Pence on the floor of the Senate. He says he didn't know anything about it. The investigation later proved otherwise, that he had heard indeed what other Trump supporters from Wisconsin were planning to do. He just hopes that you forgot about it. So they say that there's voter fraud out there. Turns out we did find some. Comes from northern Minnesota, where a woman is facing felony charges because of the voter fraud that we have discovered. She's a 50-year-old woman, and she probably is not a listener to this program, so she probably didn't hear one of our earlier segments where a local clerk in Eau Claire talks about all the safeguards that are in place for preventing duplicate voting. Because yes, they do monitor death records, and if someone has died before Election Day, even if an absentee ballot was sent to that person and returned, it gets pulled. The vote does not count from dead people on Election Day. So back to northern Minnesota. Itasca County did mail a ballot to a woman named Rose Javerina on September 20th, and they got the ballot back on October 7th. But someone in the office noticed that Rose Javerina's signature looked an awful lot like her daughter's handwriting as the witness. And her daughter's signature on her own ballot looked a lot like her mother's signature as the witness. By then, of course, it was confirmed that Rose had died on August 31st. And a check of the four signatures across the two ballot envelopes all were mighty similar to the daughter's signature as on file with her driver's license. So someone from the sheriff's office had a talk with the daughter, 50-year-old Danielle Miller, and she explained what's at the base of this alleged voter fraud. She said, you see, her mother, Rose, was an avid Donald Trump supporter and wanted to vote for Trump, but died before getting the chance. So Danielle Miller, allegedly, filled out her mom's ballot and forged her signature and forged her mother's signature as the witness on her own ballot. And Danielle Miller will now make her first court appearance on felony voter fraud charges on December 4th. So yes, Ron Johnson, the voter fraud is out there. The cheating is out there. It's just that in story after story after story after story, it appears the cheating is coming from one particular side of the aisle, those who support Donald Trump. Those who support Donald Trump tend to have some of these ethical lapses. The most recent example will be seen today in Mississippi, or in Wisconsin rather, where Donald Trump is going to be crisscrossing several states, and he is scheduled to appear in Green Bay with Brett Favre, the former Packer quarterback. The headline in the Associated Press perhaps says it best. Trump will campaign in Wisconsin with Brett Favre, who's linked to a Mississippi welfare scandal. You notice Hall of Fame quarterback isn't in there anymore. He was an NFL MVP three times. He was a Super Bowl champion. But the 55-year-old Favre, while not facing criminal charges, is one of more than three dozen people at the center of a welfare scandal. Favre has repaid just over $1 million he received in speaking funds that had been provided through what was supposed to be federal welfare funds that were sent to Mississippi. The scandal is that although Mississippi is one of the poorest states in the union and has been for decades, only a fraction of the federal money designed to go to welfare has gone to needy families. You always hear about, you know, welfare fraud and that it's people who are, you know, living lavish lifestyles and, you know, making money off of government checks. It wasn't happening for the poor families of Mississippi. It was happening to powerful people who were siphoning the money off and wasting it. Tens of millions of dollars were wasted, including some that went toward a University of Southern Mississippi volleyball arena that Brett Favre had been leading the fundraising efforts for. Now, again, he was not part of the group that necessarily knew of the welfare fraud. He's had to pay back the money once it was learned that that money was connected to that scheme. He continues to deny any wrongdoing. He continues to support Donald Trump. They will be campaigning together, to no one's surprise. Senator Chris Larson next. You're up north.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
This is usually not the song we would pick for our homeroom segment to talk about public education in Wisconsin. It's one of the rare times where the certain part of the lyric actually fits about a brick in the wall, because you may as well be talking to a brick wall when it comes to some of the ways that our state government should be supporting public education, but is not, for many reasons that we've covered here, one of the most recent of which is mandating a new reading and literacy program and then refusing to fund it, part of the political games that are being played in the state legislature. And here to talk about that and so many other related topics is State Senator Chris Larson from Milwaukee. Senator Larson, good morning. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing, Pat?
I'm very good, thank you. I would be remiss if I didn't start, however, talking about one of our colleagues, Rob Coles, and his announcement the other day that he would be voting for Vice President Kamala Harris. Coles is the longest-serving legislator currently, certainly the longest-serving Republican. I served with him 15 years ago. You serve with him now. Between his announcement and then that of the Republican mayor of Waukesha, what does that tell you about some of the Republicans that you worked with, that I've worked with, and where this election seems to be going?
Yeah, it's a, I mean, with what's not surprising is that he feels this way. Honestly, I think one of the perks of being elected and being a little bit younger is that some of the older folks in the Senate, when they think they're whispering, you usually hear most of what they're saying. And a lot of these guys have detested Donald Trump from the beginning, right? The same way the rest of us see how he's a con artist, how he is not, he's only interested in himself. And then in the latest way, since 2020, how it's very clear that he's willing to overthrow democracy and willing to overthrow every idea that is America. What's exciting about it, what's new, is finally you actually have a Republican willing to say it into a microphone, into the public, and to be able to say what everyone else knows, that the line was crossed long ago. And for Rob specifically, Trump messing around with Nazi stuff and quoting Hitler and saying he wanted Hitler's generals was too much for him, as it should be too much for anybody. I think sometimes we get this idea that, okay, there's two restaurants open at the food court. They must both be great. But, you know, taking a step back, there's one that is serving broken glass and poison, and there's one that's serving nourishing meals, right? And I think it becomes pretty clear once you're in it long enough, like Rob is.
Yeah, and look, what's in the nourishing meal may not be your favorite food, but again, the alternative is broken glass, and that right. Some people are finally willing to speak out about it. And it underscores a point that I've been making for years. And again, I've been out of the legislature for a long time, but that there are good people from both parties who serve in there, just as there are people from both parties that, frankly, are a pain in the arse to deal with. And some of them have been in charge for a very long time. So that takes us to, you know, where we are with public education. And right now, folks are mostly talking about all the referendums. And as we've said repeatedly on this program, you know, the smart way to go would be to say yes to a referendum if it's in your area, and no to any of the legislators who created the conditions that have led to all these referendums. So while we've stressed that a lot, we haven't really gotten into the new literacy program requirement, which, as I understand, not every Democrat was necessarily fond of the way that these literacy programs would work. But it's made even worse by Republicans then saying, well, we're not going to fund this. Can you explain what it is that your Republican colleagues are telling you as far as why they required a literacy program but now won't fund it?
Yeah, what's interesting is this is a bill that's been, it's taken a while for them to actually get it passed, more than one session. I was opposed to it because of the specific branding that they wanted to move forward. This is a reiteration of a fight that had happened in the 80s under George W. Bush, where they were pushing specific products out of Texas as these miracle cures for literacy. The reality is what it takes to be able to teach a child to read is quality attention and time by a skilled teacher who knows what they're doing. And there is no cheap way to do it, right? This isn't like baby, you know, you play baby Einstein and then 5 years later, your kid is a genius and can read at an eighth grade level when they're in kindergarten. It is that dedicated attention. And so finally they were able to add some dollars into it, as Pat, as you know, and people who pay close attention to state government, there's all kinds of great ideas of what legislators want to force other governments to do, but there always tends to be a shortage of dollars to actually fund them to act to do it. And so we drew the line and said, you at least have to put in some money. That gained bipartisan support, enough for the governor to sign it. And then wouldn't you know it, once it passed, the Republicans in the Joint Finance Committee, Dewey Strobel specifically, who sits on that committee, as well as Joan Bolweg, are blocking the dollars from actually being spent. So you have this mandate to do a specific literacy program within it, within these public schools, but then the dollars to hire literacy coaches and actual dedicated professionals, they're sitting on those dollars. And if that's not bad enough, Pat, I'm sure you know this, but Dewey Strobel is running in the district immediately north of mine in north of Milwaukee County. And he is bragging about the literacy program that he ushered through, that he voted for, and saying how great this is. While at the same time, he is the chair of the committee that is blocking the money from actually being spent. So trying to take credit for something that he is literally blocking at the exact same time. There's a lot of hypocrisy in politics, but I don't know if you can top that one on a local basis.
It really is difficult to top doing something the way that they appear to be doing it. The inside baseball part of it, and folks, don't let me lose you in here, but there is that line item veto that governors have. Governors, whether Republican or Democrat, can choose to veto certain parts of certain bills. If Republicans, in this case, in the legislature, don't like the line item vetoes, they can vote to override it. If they have the votes, if they don't have the votes, they can't. It's baked into the process it's legal, it gets to work. So Governor Evers has done some line item vetoes in this literacy bill, just as he did with the bill to clean up PFAS out of the drinking water, just as he did for the money that was supposed to go to the Chippewa Valley for their healthcare emergency after two hospitals closed. And Chris, after months of talking about this, I'm still trying to figure out how Republicans justify saying, well, we're not going to release the money for these things because we don't like the line item vetoes that Governor Evers put in all of these bills.
Yeah, I mean, talk about an inability to be able to work across the aisle, which I think is one of the biggest criticisms that gets put out there by folks who maybe aren't paying attention to the close details, but they think, well, wait a second, you guys should be able to figure out some of these things and work together. But in these cases, they are taking their ball and going home. They're refusing to expend the dollars. I mean, you bring up the PFAS stuff, and I'm sure your listeners are astute enough to know what PFAS are and the forever chemicals that are flowing in our water with high concentrations in different parts of the state. The legislature begrudgingly moved forward on trying to do something with PFAS. Now, the really wild part about this one is what Republicans are trying to hold over from the dollars being spent. They want to give immunity to the polluters. They want to be able to say, well, if you get these dollars, it's the equivalent of like taking a settlement check from an insurance company, that you can, if you take this, you know, pennies on a dollar for the damages, then you can't hold them liable in the future, which, as we're learning more and more, PFAS are unfortunately part of a lot of our ecosystems because they're forever chemicals. And the more we're learning, the more it's going to be essential to hold these polluting companies accountable, because a lot of them knew it. Republicans, of course, are stepping into the fray and saying, well, let's make sure you can never hold them accountable for the pollution they caused you and your children. That's why they're sitting on these dollars in the Joint Finance Committee, and why we can't address one of the biggest health crises in America.
It is really telling that they're in all of those instances trying to blame Governor Evers, saying that, you know, he's the one that won't meet us. But again, he fulfilled his part of the law. He has the right to, you know, veto portions of these bills, and in many cases to offer local governments more flexibility in how they do things. So at this point, it's not a matter of blaming Governor Evers. It sounds more like, you know, an attempt at extortion. But again, they're willing to not fund these programs, reading and water and healthcare. They're willing to sit with the water full of chemicals to try to extort some more concessions out of the governor. Obviously, we're not going to see any progress on this between now and when the legislature begins to take up the next budget in January. What's your hope, Senator Larson, about how things might be better come January, February, when you guys start working on the next 2-year state budget?
Yeah, I mean, look, we finally have fairer maps in the state of Wisconsin, which, you know, I think a lot of people recognize. I realize sometimes we get in the political talk. I'm sure your listeners know what that means. When I say that to the average person, they're saying, wait a second, did we finally get the UP? We got new maps in Wisconsin. it just means that the district lines have shifted in a way that's fairer. So votes are actually more reflective of the will of the people. The votes of people are going to reflect a greater degree in how their elected officials at the state level act in the assembly and the Senate. You know, that's why we have the assembly as a jump ball in the state of Wisconsin. There's competitive seats all over the place. If you have a state rep, if they're not in their own competitive district, they're out helping. That's where I'm going right now. If you can hear me driving in the background, to go help in a competitive district north of Dane County in the 14th for Sarah Kietzky. And this is going to change it. There will be more Democrats elected this cycle than we probably had in 12 years, because we have more Democrats running in more districts than we've had this in the 2000s. So in the last 24 years. And those folks are on the ground telling the story of exactly what's been going on at the Capitol and how we need to fund public education, how we need to give women autonomy over their own bodies, and how we need to make sure that healthcare is a right and not a privilege to be extorted, and more. So it's going to change the dynamics. And as you know, this happened right after you left the legislature, Pat. There was a rule that went down that they didn't even want us bowling with each other, Republicans and Democrats, because, gosh, you might actually get to like one another and actually get bills passed that help the people on a nonpartisan basis. So we can finally put that to an end. I don't know how soon we'll get our bowling shoes on.
Perhaps. And while we wait for him to jump to the next tower here, I want to note that Chris Hambuck Boyle put it on Facebook. Unfunded mandates for public schools force them to go to referendums across the state. So, and Chris's signal is back with us now. It's that, again, these endless referendums, perhaps something that can be addressed, because you're dealing with, you will have a multi-billion dollar surplus once again to work with. And I say that out of a sense, Chris, of insane jealousy, looking back at the 2009 budget that we had to put through at the start of the Great Recession with a $6 billion shortfall. So needless to say, I'm wishing you all the best in putting that surplus to work better than has happened the past two budget cycles.
Yeah, no, having the surplus is huge, and being able to decide what priorities we're going to spend it on, right? Because a lot of the argument has always been we don't have the funds to be able to fund K-12 public education, that higher education is not a priority. Sorry, we have to cut funds there. You know, issue after issue, local governments, local roads, all of these things. But now we're actually going to be able to invest in public education. You mentioned the referendums. We have a record number of referendums up this cycle. 243 up this year alone. Every municipality in my Senate district has had a referendum or is having one this year. And, you know, your listeners probably know already that if they haven't had a referendum, they will soon. If they've had one already, they're probably going to have another one in the next 3 to 4 years. And this is a result of Scott Walker's budgeting that restricts locals from being able to raise the revenue on their own, while the state government has hoarded all of this cash. And putting that in real sense, the dollars of what a child was worth in the state perspective on a per pupil basis is less now than it was when Scott Walker came into office in 2011. Think about that, right, a child.
It says a lot about their priorities. Yeah, exactly. Senator Chris Larson, Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Safe travels. We'll talk again after the election. Take care.
Sounds good. Thanks, Pat. Let's go win.
You bet. Todd Allbaugh coming up next. You're up north.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Well, it's not really a bus stop, but it's as close as I could come up with on a bus tour. Maybe I should have went with Magic Bus. I don't know.
I like it.
I like how you enter the show and just immediately undercut yourself with regret and self-deprecation.
This really isn't about a bus tour, but I got something in there related to a bus. Yeah. Todd's on a bus.
Well, not on a bus proper right now. We're into the plush Super 8 in Osseo, but we do have a bus. We're riding from locale to locale. And my voice is going too. Oh gosh,
I can hear that. Dude. Clearly, yeah. There must be a lot that makes Wisconsin great for you to talk about. On what it is that makes Wisconsin so wonderful.
Yeah, we're going around the state, 6 cities in 6 days. I've got my Wonder State coffee right here in my hot little hands. That's where we were yesterday in beautiful Viroqua, Wisconsin, in the Driftless in southwest Wisconsin. Stopped in there, had TJ, one of the owners of Wonder State, had one of the local people from Community Radio, WDRT, there in Viroqua, and also talked to Lee Rosh, of course, longtime involved at Western Wisconsin Technical College, and now is working for a pro-democracy institute to help kind of spread the love and help people understand the truth about voting. So, and then Trigvi Olson, our friend from the Lincoln Project, native of River Falls, is along. And Reed Galen, one of the co-founders of Lincoln Project and now president of the union. So the union picked up the tab for the bus. That was very nice of them. So because as we were loading in, the bus driver said, "You usually put all of this in your truck?" He said, "That's why there's only room for Trippy and I, and we do these things."
And now from now on,
or the case,
like,
or Jane.
I always want a bus.
Yes. I don't think that's a bad demand at all. And I love these bus tours. I love your tours around Wisconsin. getting the listeners more involved and allowing them even more of a say and get more local flavor, especially mm-hmm. in these days prior to an election, that it's not a, you're not a candidate, you're not a campaign, you're not an interest group. You're just a couple of chuckleheads with microphones who want to talk about the positive things about Wisconsin. Yeah. So let me ask it this way.
Sure, please.
What's the best case scenario coming out of this election? Let's not have anybody be fooled. Best case scenario is not some kind of like liberal fever dream where everything on Bernie Sanders' wish list is going to come true. That's never been the goal. But there is a goal that if everything on a Donald Trump wish list comes true, things ain't going to be so good about this. So what in your mind is a good or best case scenario coming out of this election?
Well, I think maybe one of the underreported stories, and I'll put myself in the guilty category of this, is not talking about what could happen in the state legislature. And today, speaking of a local, Pat, we're going to be at the beautiful Norske Nook here in Osseo having pie and coffee and talking to folks. That's where we're doing the show from today.
Hey, Greg, be careful. With all that drool coming out of us, both of us, we're going to electrocute ourselves.
I
want to
be on a bus tour.
Next time, come on along. But Jody Emerson, State Representative Jody Emerson, is going to be here. We're going to be talking about it at 1 o'clock and talking about these very important state legislative races. So, Pat, to answer your question, I think the best case scenario is, maybe we get a split in the legislature where the Democrats control the Assembly and the Republicans barely control the Senate and Tony Evers in the executive office. And that will force maybe listening to people and having to actually work together to get something done that is more centrist, which I think is in the best interest of voters. So going to be talking about that. Also, we have Craig Gilbert from former journalist, the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, talking about the new Marquette Law School poll, which will be released around noon. And we'll talk to Craig about 12:30. And then we have, who else do we have? Oh, we have Elise Jordan from MSNBC's Morning Joe, a friend of Trigvi Olson. She'll be on at 1:30. So talking about all of that today. But I think as we're out here on the road, Pat, two things strike me. One, being up here away from the Madison media market, the vitriol, the hatred, the negativity, the sickness of the Republican ads, even at the state assembly level. Mike Hipsch's son, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Totally disgusting ad against State Representative Steve Doyle of the La Crosse area that's transphobic, hateful, and spiteful. I think that the big question here is what does this issue they're ginning up in these ads, how does that affect the U.S. Senate race? How does that affect down ballot races in the state assembly? At the end of the day, I put my hope and trust in Wisconsin, that our community is what binds us together, and people are going to vote for people who support our local schools, our communities, our ag producers.
I hope so. But like I said earlier this hour, I've also seen Ron Johnson be dragged across the finish line by some of the most disgusting ads out there that just enough people buy into.
And really, really quickly, if you're someone who's on the fence, a person who's maybe leaning towards voting Democratic, please vote today. Please vote early, or at least vote on election day proper. Don't vote third party. Don't vote Jill Stein. A vote for third party or Jill Stein in quote-unquote protest over the Palestinian issues or whatever, that is a vote for Trumpism. That is a vote for hate. All Trump will do is put Bibi Netanyahu and tell him to do whatever the hell you want. So I'm not condoning everything, but if you think that Trump is going to give you a better Palestine, you are sadly mistaken, and you are on the wrong side of history.
And by the way, there's a shady Republican group that is really playing that up now, sending fake digital ads to college students and other young adult voters, urging them to vote against Tammy Baldwin because she's not doing enough for Gaza. And it's completely off base, sick. It's dark money funded, so you don't see that it's just Republicans making mischief. So
I'll say this quickly. Yep. Vote for Tammy Baldwin. This race is much closer than people think. Democrats are asleep at this. Eric Hovde is gaining. Tammy needs every single vote. Get out and canvass.
And we'll hear much more in the poll later today. And then you've got the bus tour that continues. So safe travels. We'll talk to you real soon.
Thanks, Patrick. We appreciate it. Thanks, Greg. Bye-bye.
All right. And coming up, Greg Bach is back 2 hours from now for Matt and Air on Air.
Yes, indeed.
With Dr. Kristen, how do you say this? Lyerly is the name?
Yes. That's an upcomer, newcomer to the political scene. A doctor, I guess. We'll see what she has to say.
And running for Congress as well.
So that's coming up too.
At 10. Yes, at 10:30. Thanks to all of you for being part of Up North News Radio. Enjoy your Wednesday. Follow us at upnorthnewswi.com. We'll see you tomorrow morning here up north.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.